It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. So undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. As you hold me deeper still, as you hold me deeper still, as you hold me still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And you're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Good morning, everyone. If you'd stay standing just for the memory verse here, and then we'll have a seat. Let's say this together. Here we go. Be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Amen. You can be seated. Just a couple of announcements before we pray for the service and then continue worshiping. Last week, Pastor John did a great job of kind of explaining some of the needs of Chapel Hill Christian Academy as we continue to grow. I did want to add one thing to that, though. When he said we are looking for teachers, that is accurate, but you do not need to be licensed by the state of Ohio. We are a non-taxpayer, non-chartered Christian school. So we can kind of set some of our own rules when it comes to those things. So if you have any interest in working at Chapel Hill Christian Academy, you can see Beth Trent, you can see myself, you can see Carrie Wisner, and we'll see about getting you involved if that's something that interests you. Deacon Tom gave me this set of keys and asked me to see if they belong to anyone. They've been sitting around here for a couple of weeks. I will give them back to him. So if they're yours, you're locked out of something. So you might need them. Happy birthday to Carol Biggs. My understanding is today is her birthday. So happy birthday to her. And on that note, let's go to the Lord. We'll pray for her because, you know, she lives with Dick and, you know, she probably needs prayer. So let's pray for the service and pray for the offering, and then we'll ask God's blessing on us today. Father, as we come before you today on this Father's Day, we thank you that you are our good, good Father, Lord. You are available to us anytime, any place, anywhere, Lord. For those of us who have a saving relationship with you, you say that we can boldly come before the throne of grace, Lord. So, Father, thank you so much for showing us what it means to be a good, good Father. Lord, I pray that you would be with John today as he brings the message. And I know there's some excited campers here who had a wonderful week, Lord. Be with him as he guides our service today, Lord. Use him to bring glory to your name. And Father, as people at this church have continued to give, Lord, Lord. It's dropping their offering and the plates that we just keep setting there, Lord. We don't even pass them out anymore. Or it's giving online, Lord. Bless them for being obedient to you. Father, we ask all of this in the powerful, holy name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us today?
That was just a joke. You can be seated. That was my bad. Everybody's, hey, what denomination are we in? some of you just instinctively knelt right back down. Haley, if you would, Tom, crank the we're going to play a short video for camp, a recap, and then we're going to talk a little bit about camp this week. All right, I'm going to ask those who went to camp, our counselors and campers, come on up. I want to share a few. We had a tremendous week. First, I wanted to start out by just thanking all of you who gave for our special camp offering. You were so generous. It helped so many of these teens. There's some who couldn't be here this morning, but just so, so thankful. We wanted to start out by expressing our thanks to you. You guys can just line up back here. I wanted to just take a few minutes and give a quick recap. And, oh, good night. Scared me there, brother. So speaking of this, just stay right here. We had a phenomenal week at camp. It was really flawless. We were all packed up, and we were like an hour out from having just a quick celebration service and then getting on the bus and heading home. And Lucas, we had two cabins. Lucas came over and was checking on us, and the grass was wet. It was like 7:30 or 8 o'clock in the morning, and he goes, as he'd done all week, to jump off of the porch, and he jumps down, and I wish I had it on video. It was a tremendous wipeout, and he's laying there, lame, and he's looking up at me like, what am I going to do? And he said, yeah, I heard it snap. It snapped. It snapped. So we took him to the nurse's cabin, but I'm glad he's standing here living to tell about it, so you can go back and understand. So close to a flawless week. I want Beth to come up here, and we don't have time for everyone to share the teens. The teens sent a few texts. I'll touch on a couple of those. I would love for all of us to be able to share something, but being that it's Father's Day, I also feel responsibility and compelled to preach on Father's Day, but I did want to, before Beth shares, I wanted to say a special thank you to Mike Kirby, to Kim Schaller, and to Beth Trent, who gave up a week of their summer, a week away from their family, to come and support these teens and love these teens and invest in these teens for an eternal impact. So I think they deserve a round of applause. And Beth led the girls, and so I wanted her just to share a couple of highlights.
Good morning. We made it for another week of camp. John mentioned he wasn't sure how much time we were going to have, and normally I would try to prepare something, but this group needs no preparation when it comes to being thankful for them. They did a fantastic job. One thing that stuck out for me, because I'll make it short, is that each one of these kids chose to put their life here in town on hold for an entire week, and they did it willingly. Which isn't always easy. We have kids here that work, we have kids in sports, we have kids doing a lot of things, and each one of them willingly chose to be at camp this week. And I truly believe that each one of them were very thankful at the end of the week that they chose to go. But what stuck out to me was the last night of camp, the theme was I'll go. Each night there was a different night, but that last one stuck out to me because each one of these kids, I believe, are more prepped to go out into this world, go out into our communities, go out into our schools. And they're stronger in their faith, they're stronger in their friendships. And this was just another level of our foundation of our youth group being built upon for the years to come. So I'm very thankful for them. They did a fantastic job and they represented our church very, very well.
I learned some new vocabulary this week. When things were really great, they were bussin'. No cap. Oh, I'm serious, no cap. That means no lie. And then we got into, and I still don't know if I know what this means. I don't know if anybody else does, but scuzzy. So everybody ended up being, or like Chapel Hill Scuzzy Youth Group. Now that doesn't sound too great, but whatever that that means, we're together. And then lit, LITTTTTTT. All week long, things were lit. Now we got on a group text so we could keep in touch with everyone. And when we got home, so of course we had dozens and dozens and dozens of texts all through the week. What are you doing? Where are you? What's going on now? And when we got home, since Friday afternoon at 1:30 when we got back here to the church, since Friday to this Sunday, hundreds of texts blowing up my phone and everybody else's phone of everyone wanting to stay in contact. And I would say out of those hundreds, about 275 of them have the word lit, L-I-T-T-T-T-T-T-T-T in it. Everything's lit. I read a text as the texts were going on this morning, and they said things are dripping lit. So it was great. I wanted to just mention, and I don't have time to go through all of them, but I had them send me testimonies. By the way, speaking of Kim Schaller, I thought it was really touching. She wrote a novel about camp. I asked everyone, I said, send me a text, and I'll try to read a few of them, and just to highlight and let you guys know the impact you made. But she said when she was, and Tom and Kim have been coming to our church now for probably a year or two, but they, oh, hey girl, you come right up here. Come on, come on. So, oh, I'm so glad you showed up. You want to talk about lit? There it is, right there. So, but Kim, she said when she, and she's worked at a lot of summer camps, a lot of youth camps over the years, Christian camps, and she said, we're newer to the church. She said, our kids are in the youth group, but we're just kind of getting to know people. And she said, I was riding down on the bus, and I thought, am I really supposed to be here? Should I, you know, did I, she offered to go but she wrote just an absolute, and she mentioned almost every one of these kids and how she saw God work in their lives. But I'm so thankful, Kim, you were meant to go, and God did lead you to go. And all the girls loved Beth, and we know her for so many years, but I received text after text after text of how God used Kim and the girls and the boys' lives to bless them. So again, thank you to our counselors. Just a couple, and I feel bad I can't mention them all, but I appreciate it. I just mentioned some of these texts that I received the past couple of days. Jaden, raise your hand right there. And this is a young youth group, so I don't want to put pressure on them to have to come up and speak. That's always fun, but I promised them I wouldn't force them to speak. But he wrote to me, and he said, the message is from Lonnie. Now, we had a preacher from Texas come in and did a great job. He said, the messages from Lonnie showed me how to fight temptation better, and the music and everything was super cool and lit. All right? And then he said, so are we doing it again next year? ? On Thursday, I personally made a commitment that wherever I go, I'll show others the love of Christ in me. The whole experience was a renewal of Christ in me. Thank you, Jaden. Brock wrote, the song We Praise You really stuck out to me because I literally had it in my head all week. And I tell you, it was a miracle because if you could have seen Brock on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday morning, that head of hair looked like he stuck his fingers in an electrical outlet. So, but he said, We Praise You was in his heart all week. He said, I got some things right with the Lord, and I am more committed to his leading in my life. Ethan, now, there were no deaths at camp. But we lost power, like many of you did. We lost it for a full 24 hours on the record heat index of this year so far. And so at 5 o'clock on Monday night, after a few hours of being there, the camp went no power. They were cooking by flashlights. We had 650-plus campers and counselors there. So they were cooking with generators. Then we went into the gym and had this service, and it was all by just a couple of lights. So it was there was no sound system, so that all of these kids and campers had to just be quiet the whole time. We only had a guitar for the music that first night and then for the following morning. So until 5 p.m. Tuesday night. Well, our cabins turned into saunas. They have air conditioning. But when we got into the boys' cabin, I'm an experienced. I've been there over 20 years, and so I always liked it. And of course, I'm older now. I like the bottom bunks, but they have bunks. So all the boys were in there, and they went straight to the top bunks. And they're like, oh, yeah, we got a top bunk. This is awesome. And they're all fired up. Well, you go up about 6-7 feet into a cabin where the ceiling's only 2 feet away, and it's 113-degree heat index, and you get in there. All of a sudden, they found out that wasn't the coolest spot. Well, I told all the kids when we lined up and got ready to go on Monday morning, we met out here before we loaded up, and I just gave them a few rules, a few encouragements, and I said, hey, one thing, we're all going to get close, we're going to hang out. I said, you know, when you come into the cabins, you're exhausted, you just kind of want to flop anywhere where there's an open spot. I said, stay out of each other's bunks, because you're going to be hot, you're going to be sweaty. Well, some of our guys forgot about that because they were so exhausted. I come into the cabin, and after we were just drenched, the boys had gone back with Mike, and I had to do a few things, and then I came back to the cabin, and I opened the door. I went to Target or Walmart and bought a new sheet. I forgot a sheet, brand new, beautiful sheet tucked on my bed. I like things in order, so I had everything just laid out there, and I come in, and there is a soaked orange human laying on my mattress. My instinct was to first of all say, are you saved? Do you know the Lord? Because I'm getting ready to kill you, okay? So that commandment up there on those boards, that's I was struggling with that. So anyway, I didn't say that was Ethan, did I? He was planning to be back there today. I said, oh, I'm going to get you for that. And he said, I'll mute you. So I brought him up here and used somebody else back there. The Lord did a great work in Ethan's life, and we had a great week together. He said, looking at all those 650-plus campers was a great reminder that we're not in this alone. That was powerful. He said, I really thought this was great. He said, when I closed my eyes during the worship services, the lyrics were as though God was talking directly to me. There are people everywhere who need to be saved, and God was telling me specific names of people I need to talk to. So Ethan, raise your hand so everybody knows who you are. Cameron, raise your hand, wave to everybody. Cameron wrote this. She said, the service that spoke to me most was when Lonnie talked about finding your faith on your own when you grew up in it, always knowing about Christianity. I grew up in a godly family, but not everyone has that blessing. I made a commitment to go out into the world and spread the good news. I also made a commitment to silence my phone in the evenings and read my Bible every night. And then Regs, where are you, Reagan? It was really neat, and one great motivation besides all of these teens and this church family for me to go to camp was my daughter is first year being a teenager, and so I wanted to be there with her and share that. And during the worship, Reagan wrote me this. She said, I was so moved by the worship each night, and she leaned over. I sat beside her one night, and we were just enjoying worship together, and she leaned over and put her head on my shoulder, and she said, Dad, I feel like this week God is moving me, and maybe I'm being called to do what they're doing up there on the stage and to be a worship leader someday. And so I'm thankful for how the Lord is working in Reagan's life and in all of our teens' lives. Then Thursday night, so we have a young youth group. We're still getting to know one another. That's one of the great things about camp. But there was one teen who went, who I think is probably the newest addition to our youth group. Nadia, come up here. This is Nadia Montgomery, and if I could give the meaning of Nadia, it would just be lit. she is a burst of energy, and we had such a good time together. But Nadia is newer to our youth group. It was great. She began to come a couple of months ago. We had a youth group activity at Pizza Hut, and while we were sitting there, the Lord was working in her life at Pizza Hut. And Connie Jackson and Josh were there that night, and Connie took her over to a table. And Nadia, she was saying, talking about salvation, and Connie said, well, why wait? Do you want to do it right now? She said, well, yeah. And so they prayed, and she repented of her sins and asked Christ to save her at Pizza Hut just a few weeks ago. But all week long with the power outage and everything, it was a different feel of the week, and I was striving. Again, I'm a veteran camper, and I was striving to teach our youth group to take a step in their relationship with the Lord and then just go a little bit deeper and not be satisfied with a shallow walk, but to go deeper. And so we were working towards that, and I was striving to lead the kids in that. And Thursday night, after the message and after the worship, we had a small group, and we went out by the river and sat down together, and the Lord met with us in a tremendous way. And you could literally feel in a tangible way the presence of the Lord and the gelling together of these young people and these counselors. And the Lord used Nadia and her testimony in her life. Before it was all said and done, the kids just loved being crazy. And we would start getting a little bit serious, and then someone would get lit. And we'd just kind of lose it. Well, we hit a serious, deeper moment Thursday night, and I said, now listen, before we go back to humor, I said, I want us to stay in this. I want you to open up your heart, and let's keep in this little bit of depth here. And so I talked about a few of the teens, and I mentioned Nadia and how proud I was of her. And Nadia looked around at everyone, and she said, okay. Now, she's been goofy all week long, but she got serious, and she looked at all of your children, your kids, and these campers, and she said, I need you to know, I want you to know, all of you are my family, and I love you. And so, Nadia has a story. She recently came from Columbus and is living here in our community and in our county. But I want to challenge you that in the coming weeks, coming days, pray for each one of these teens. They are our future. They are this church. They are our leaders. They are our pastors. They are our missionaries. They are our worship leaders. And it's going to go like that. We're 26 years in here at Chapel Hill. And I went to camp the first year, 26 years ago. Mike Kirby and I began to go to preteen camp together as a team. It was so cool. After all these years, we were back together, working together at camp as counselors. And when we started going to camp, on the last night, I had the kids raise their hands. Who was born back in 2003 when Mike and I started going to camp to lead the preteens and the teens, and none of them raised their hands. None of them were even born. So it was really cool that Mike and myself and Beth and Kim were able to lead a new generation. And like Ethan said, these kids know when they go into environments like that, they are not alone. And there's more with us than be with them. We're on the winning side. Amen. So teens, I'm proud of you guys. I love you. And I'd like for all of you to give them a hand for a great week. Great week. You guys can sit down. Thank you. You guys can go.
This week was a crazy week for so many, as we all experienced this massive storm, and I didn't feel super sorry for them only losing power for 24 hours because we just got ours on last night. But I thank the Lord when I woke up this morning and flipped lights on and I was cool and it was wonderful. Just all the blessings we take for granted. But on Monday night when the storm came through, Chad and I were both asleep and we were just awakened. It literally sounded like a freight train, which of course they say a tornado sounds like a freight train. So I ran out of bed, Chad grabbed Zane, and we ran downstairs and I just sat there and listened. It was really unbelievable. And I just kept going between, you know, praying, oh, dear Lord, please protect us, keep us safe. And also just being in complete awe of what was going on outside with the lightning and the thunder. And you could hear the trees falling over. And just the reminder of who our God is that controls the winds and the waves. And at His voice, it will stop and it will cease. And in the morning, we, you know, as the storm passed, we went on back upstairs and we tucked Zane in. And that next morning when he woke up, we were telling him all about it. And when we took him downstairs, he talked to us a little bit and kind of mumbled, you know, and we reassured him and kissed him and told him, Zane, we love you, you know. But the next morning, he remembered none of it. And he was like, what? What happened? So we started telling him, and you look out our window and his playset, there's a couple of trees down around it. And the more we looked, the more we found, we just have literally, I mean, it's just complete destruction in our woods. We've got multiple trees that were completely uprooted and piled on top of each other, and you know, trees on top of trailers, trees on top of our trails, just everywhere was just a disaster. And Zane was looking around and he came over and he scooted next to me on the couch and cuddled up and he said, Mom, I feel kind of scared right now. And I said, well, Zane, the storm's over. Like, you're safe. Daddy took you downstairs. Everything was fine. I said, and Zane, do you remember telling us that, you know, you loved us and us talking to you? And he's like, what? I talked to you? And as I got to thinking about it, I just thought, you know, isn't that so much like our relationship with the Lord? Because even when we don't know it, even when the storms are raging around us, when a battle's about to come that we have no idea we're going to face, our Lord is not only holding us, but He's speaking over us, and He's singing over us, and He's telling us how much He loves us. And so often, we may even be responding, oh, I love you, Lord. But we don't even know that it's happening. And yet when the reality sets in of the chaos and the destruction, I mean, we're safe, but we're still gonna have literally months of work of cleaning up and repairs and all, you know, dealing with insurance and all that. And not at all complaining, because we are safe, our house is safe, and God was so good and kept us safe. But we still have to deal with things, and that's how life is. You still have heartache, you still have the sorrow, but yet Above all, there is a heavenly Father who will protect us and who will carry us and who is speaking life into us when we don't even realize. And this morning, if you just look around and you'll see the evidence of his goodness, because even if you are in the midst of a storm, even if you are in the midst of sorrow, even if you have been betrayed, even if you don't have a relationship with a father, even if your father has passed on, if you've never been able to be a father, I know today is hard for so many, but even if the evidence of God is still all over your life, he is still good, he is still faithful, he still loves you, and he will carry you, and you can just rest in his arms and know that no matter what comes your way, he is good, he is God, and we are safe. So this morning, let's stand and sing about the evidence of his goodness. Children ages 4 to 12 to Kids Church, and ages 3 and under dismissed to the nursery. As they go out, let's just continue singing. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after. to me. All the evidence is there. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Cause your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Oh, sing it out. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running.
Please take your Bibles and turn to Proverbs chapter 20. And while you're turning there, let me say, so good to see Pete and Edie back in the services today. Pete, welcome back. And they've been out for some time after Pete's surgery, and so we're so very grateful to have him back, and Edie, and we're grateful you're here. I want to just preach on one verse of Scripture today. And preach on a godly father. I'm doing something today that I don't usually do. I'm preaching from a verse that I preached from on Father's Day 2019. It's rare for me to do this, to return to a passage so quickly, because once I preach from a specific area of Scripture, I like to let it rest, because as a pastor and a shepherd, I want to give to you a balanced diet of God's Word as best I can and not just stay too long on one place. And so the last month, on May 22nd, almost 1 month ago today, because of a news story that broke, I immediately thought of Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 7. And I felt compelled on that day that I should preach from this scripture on this Father's Day 2022. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7, says this: a righteous man walks in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are the model father. You are the godly father that we follow. I pray today, Lord, after a full morning already of being grateful and rejoicing for how you're working in young people's lives, in children's lives, that, Lord, you would now work in the parents' lives and specifically in the fathers. Our world has a vacuum of godly male leadership. Godly dads, godly fathers, the statistics of girls who stray and boys who rebel and families who fall apart. The statistics are shocking when the father is absent. So Lord, I pray today that you would galvanize, encourage, convict, and strengthen us to be godly fathers. That we would be men of integrity in a day when integrity and walking with Christ and standing for the truth is being pushed aside and mocked and ridiculed. So Lord, today give us courage and give us backbone to be men of God, to be godly dads, to shepherd our families well by following the chief shepherd, our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. The righteous man. I want to say four things. I'll strive to be brief. But it starts out by saying the righteous man. So first, we're seeing a picture of a forgiven father. Or a found father. Who was once lost, but now is found. Was blind, but now sees. And he is a forgiven father. The word righteous here in Proverbs 20 verse 7 means just. This is a just father. This is a lawful father. Lawful according to God's directives, according to God's word. This word righteous means justified and vindicated by God. He is righteous because he has been found and forgiven of his sins. This word righteous also means in the original language guided by truth. So not only is he a found and forgiven man, but after he has been saved, he walks in the way of the word of the Lord and walks in the way of truth. This is referencing the righteous man, a holy, God-fearing, Christ-following, gracious, surrendered, spirit-filled, loving, joyful, peaceful, peacemaking, sacrificial, self-controlled. This is speaking of a righteous father who is present. It's very evident in this verse that this is a present dad. He doesn't check out, but he stays with his duty of being a shepherd to his children and to his family. Dads, you don't lead and you don't father from your strength, your personal strength. You don't lead and shepherd your family from your ability alone or your reason or your intelligence. You father from the position of being a found and forgiven man. That is what the Bible says that a godly father is. He is a righteous man, not of works. Ephesians 2, lest anyone should boast. No, it is all of Christ that you are who you are to your family as a righteous man. I have gone and visited a doctor in this community. And I'm sure if I mention his name, many of you have been to see him. He's a very intelligent man, a very well-rounded man, a good-looking man, a smiling man. But if you follow his life and you look at what he promotes, even online, he's a playboy. He is a rabble-rouser. As my father would say, even in his older years, he is a juvenile delinquent. He's got the money. He's got the status. He's got the title. He's got the reputation. He is full of knowledge. Super smart guy. Strong in intellect. Very capable. Very gifted. But you can be full of knowledge till it's pouring out of your ears and be void and have a vacuum of wisdom. Knowledge without wisdom is not enough, dads. If you want to be a godly dad, you must be a righteous man. You must recognize that you are lost and you need to be found, and you must recognize that you are a sinner and you need to be forgiven. I want you to turn to Romans chapter 1. Hold your place in Proverbs. We're going to finish walking out through that verse. But Romans chapter 1, verse 16. The Apostle Paul wrote this: "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it," here we go, "for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." You're sitting here today with your family and your children, and you say, "I want to be a godly father." Then you will have to become a righteous man. Not of anything that you can produce or fabricate in and of yourself. You will find, like Romans chapter 1, verse 17 says here, that it is the righteousness of Christ in you that causes you to be a godly man. And the just, the righteous, shall live by faith. It is not by works, it is not by your strength, it is by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, turn over to the next book, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Once again, the Apostle Paul in verse 20. Look what he writes here. He says, "We are ambassadors, we are representatives for Christ, as though God," this is so powerful. Fathers, listen, you are to be righteous men who are representatives, who are responsible to represent Christ to your children and to your family. It says, "We are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us." Let's just pause there for a moment. Dad, your leadership in your family, your spiritual leadership, when you open your mouth, is that to your children? Is it as if God was speaking to them through you? Because that's what the Bible says you are to be as a Christ follower. You are to be his mouthpiece. You are to be his representative. "We are Christ's ambassadors, as if God were speaking through us." Continuing on the verse, "We implore you," we plead with you, we beg with you, dads. "We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. If you're not found, get found. If you're not righteous, get righteous." How? Through the blood of Jesus. "Be reconciled to God." And here it is. This is so good. "For he," speaking of Jesus, "for he made him who knew no sin," God the Father made Jesus his son, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him," in Jesus Christ. That's so good. And so back to Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7, the Bible says you are to be a righteous man. You are to be a godly man. I was having breakfast with James Trent, Casey Swanson, myself, and Eli Johnson, and we've been discipling him for the past couple of months, and just investing in him as a Christ follower and a new convert. We were sitting there a couple of weeks ago. It was June the 2nd. He said, "Guys, 18 days. It's going to be my birthday." And, you know, your kids tell you that. They're always telling you about your birthday. But Eli's up in his mid-30s. And so we were like, "Oh, that's nice." He could tell we weren't too impressed by that. He goes, no. He said, "It's in 18 days, it is my spiritual birthday. It was on Father's Day 2021 that I came into the church and I heard the gospel, and I held a little Ziploc bag of Cheez-Its and Swedish fish, and I walked forward and laid them on the altar and surrendered my life to Christ, and I've never been the same." Never been the same. So, happy birthday, Eli. And we've seen as the year has gone on, little Bella coming and following in the footsteps of a young, righteous man. And then seeing his wife, Ashley, coming. Ashley, so proud of you for being here. Such a delight to have you guys in our young families and part of our church family that begin serving and awesome. Great testimony. My dad loves this song. I'll never forget him and my aunts when my grandmother, Phyllis, dad's mom, passed away, standing there at the graveside, lifting their eyes heavenward and singing these words. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Than Jesus' blood and righteousness. My hope is built on nothing. Not money, not physical strength, not intelligence, not on what I own, not on my materials, not on what kind of truck I drive, not what kind of house I own, not what kind of investments I have. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. And then they really got into it. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. The righteous man, Proverbs says, the righteous man. Dads, are you a righteous man? Have you surrendered your life to Christ? Continuing on the verse, it says, the righteous man walks. He walks. Now again, this is speaking in the context of a father, as we will see throughout the remainder of the verse. So we have a forgiven father, a found and forgiven father. Second, we have a followed father. He is a righteous man who walks. You know, as a man of God, the Bible tells us over and over and over again, as a man of God, we are to run. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, let us run the race. Isaiah, we will mount up with wings like eagles and we will run and not be weary. But the Bible slows your pace down as a father. He says, dads, you need to stop walking through the mall at 90 miles an hour. Quit walking on the beach at 115 miles an hour and let the little duffers keep up with you. It says the righteous man walks. You slow down your cadence in order to teach and train your children in real time at a pace that they can keep up with. I want you to look at Psalm, just the next book over, Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Verse 16. I'm sorry, verse 1. Psalm 119, verse 1. It says this, blessed, that is the word for happy. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who, what? Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart. They are all in. They're fully surrendered. They also do no iniquity. What do? They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes, then I would not be ashamed. Dad, you can live in such a way that you do not have to be filled with shame and embarrassment and regret. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes, keep your word, keep your commandments. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. John Maxwell said, a leader knows the way, goes the way and shows the way. I will paraphrase it by saying a father, a dad knows the way. He goes the way, and at a pace that your children can keep up with, he shows the way. Have you ever grown up with a father, or you yourself have said this to your children? Do this. Why? Because I said so, that's why. You ever repeated that? Do this. Why? Because I said so, that's why. Could I give you a better, I believe, more biblical option of response? Do this. Why? Because I do so. That's how. Walk this way. Why? Because I do so. That's how. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 7, how can kids follow God when they leave and are absent or move on from the home? Here's how. The Bible says to you fathers in Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 through 7, these commands, this scripture, this word, I give you this day to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. These commandments that I give you this day, you shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house. Sit down, dads. Sit down. If you're a man of God, you are to run. As a father, you are to walk. And there are times you are to sit down. Turn the TV off. Put the smartphone down. Forget the football game. And sit down with your kids. It says, you shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way. When you lie down. And when you rise up, it is a life song of walking with the Lord, with your children by your side. Do this. Why? Because I do so. That's how. There are a lot of dads who are good dads, godly dads, but they lead too far ahead. And they're constantly looking back at their kids. Come on! Come on! Get with it! Let's go! You can do better! I expect more out of you! Why can't you be like your brother? And the Bible says, you just need to have a seat. And let your kids catch up to you. Put them in bed. Tell them you love them. Pray with them. When you get up, sit back down. Eat some breakfast with them. Talk to him about loving the Lord. And then when you get out, it says, walk with them by the way. So it's not come on, it's come here. And you extend that hand and you allow them to walk and follow your leadership with you. With you. It's a picture of Christ. I will never leave you or forsake you. And behold, I am with you always. Dads, be with your children. Thirdly, we see a faithful father. Proverbs 20, verse 7 says, the righteous man walks in his integrity. Walks in his integrity. That is the word integer. Integrity comes from the word integer. It means whole number. It means complete. It means undivided. James talks about a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. When Jacob was judging his sons, he looked at his sons and he said to his firstborn, Reuben, you are as unstable as water. You're just all over the place. And the Bible says, dads, you are to be a whole, undivided, straight-shooting, narrow-walking man and father of God. The righteous man walks in his integrity. I've told you for over two decades about my heroes. My dad, Daniel Levi Wisner, my grandfather, Levi William Wisner, my mother's father, John Willett Vess. Now, none of these men are well known. My Levi, Papaw Wisner, was well known for a season of history because of his stand he took for Christian schools and the Ohio Supreme Court battle that the Lord won on their behalf. But as the years went on, people didn't really know any of these men on a certainly not on a national scale for most of their lives. They are my heroes, but I also have some other heroes that you've heard me talk about. Adrian Pierce Rogers. My son is named Jonathan Adrian Gibbs Wisner. I've talked often about my friendship and my love for Junior Hill. In more recent years, my affection and my respect and appreciation for Alistair Begg, who more than likely is preaching at this very moment in Cleveland, Ohio, and went and heard him preach at his pastor's conference in May. I'll also mention another name that is dear to my heart. I've gone to multiple pastors' conferences with him. I've talked to him in person. He's called me on the phone. We've emailed. He has been a mentor to me. And he's influenced my life in regards to preaching and leadership, along with these other men, like few other men have, including Steve Thompson. Changed my life. Johnny pastored for many years until his transition out in 2019. And I have many quotes that I've memorized from him. I have all of his books. When I became pastor in 2018, my wife gave me a plaque with Johnny Hunt's quote that is in this book, and you will see it's a signed copy where I went over towards Columbus to Jersey Baptist where he was preaching a pastor's conference, and he signed it for me, Johnny Hunt, and the scripture that he wrote and he always wrote when he signed his name was Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7. The righteous man walks in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. I've heard him preach that scripture for 25 years. That day, the quote that is on this plaque, it says, and he, on August 24th, 2017, at that pastor's conference, he had a breakout session, and he sat with all of us pastors, all of us young guys who look up to him. And he said, guys, stay close and clean. Stay close and clean. Since 2018, when I became the pastor in my dad's place, this is sat in my study. I see it every day. Stay close and clean. He also said that day, build the inner man. I wrote those quotes in this book that he wrote, Demolishing Strongholds, that I've walked through some of our men here. On May 22nd of this year, a report came out of a lot of pastors and leaders. There was an investigation that was done. And the one name that was mentioned that had fallen into sin back in 2000, in the mid-2000s, and the Christian world was shocked by it, rocked by it, because the one name at the top of the report was Johnny Hunt. And Johnny wrote a 3-page letter to his former church family and confessed sin and was very repentant towards his church family and towards his sin. And when I look at that testimony and reminder of a man that I didn't know personally, but I've had a close relationship with for well over almost two-thirds of my life. And I see that quote, when you come into my study, you're still going to see that plaque sitting where everyone can see it, for mainly two reasons. One, it's a reminder that God's grace is greater than all of our sin. Amen. It's also a stinging reminder that the best of men are men at best. And unless you, Father and Dad, and unless I keep ourselves humble, when Johnny got into sin, he was at the pinnacle of his ministry. President of the Southern Baptist Convention, pastored a church of thousands upon thousands of, traveled all over the world, wrote books, and yet he was not immune to temptation. And you are not, and I am not. And the Bible says that a righteous man, a righteous father, walks in his integrity, and his children are blessed after him. And dads, I want to encourage you today, stay close and clean. Stay close and clean, but because we are getting ready to see the outcome. Johnny was 57, I believe. This year he will turn 70 years of age. And he wrote in that three-page letter, he said, I've almost lost everything in my life except for my faith in God and my family and my faithful, loving, forgiving wife. He said, I've almost lost everything. They've taken his name down out of the seminaries. They've removed his title as pastor. By God's grace, dads, we can and we will, by the grace of God, stay close and clean. Stay close and clean. Be a man of integrity. I want you to look at Psalm chapter 7. Two verses in Psalms. Psalm chapter 7, verse 8. David writes, the Lord shall judge the peoples. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to my integrity within me. And then go to Psalm chapter 26, verse 1. Scripture says, vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity. I have also trusted in the Lord. I shall not slip. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Test me and try my mind and my heart. For your loving kindness is before my eyes, and I have walked in your truth. I have not sat with idolatrous mortals, nor will I go in with hypocrites. I have hated the assembly of evildoers and will not sit with the wicked. I will wash my hands in innocence. So I will go about your altar, O Lord, that I may proclaim with the voice of thanksgiving and tell of all your wondrous works. Lord, I have loved the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Now, fathers, by God's grace, you can be faithful. We are all going to be judged by our conduct. We are all going to be judged by the Lord for our actions. We are all going to be judged by the Lord for how we lived our life on this earth. But there's going to be some other judges that when you are gone and you are passed from this life, there's some other judges that will make assessments and that will give reports about your life. And those are your children. And they will tell the story, and they will know the story. So dads, for your children's sake and for the glory of God, stay close and clean. Stay close and clean. Because if you are a found and a forgiven father, and you walk at a pace that you are a followed father, and by the grace and forgiveness and your repentance, by the way, all of the heroes in the Bible, if you go to Hebrews 12 and you go to the Hall of Faith, all of them were flawed, deeply sinful men. And so the one thing that I can see about Johnny Hunt, that thank the Lord he repented and he confessed his sins, and I learned from his sin, and it stings and it's painful. But the Bible says that the Word of God will not return void, and everything that he has taught me and trained me when it comes to Scripture is still in there. It's still influencing me. It's still helping me. It's still guiding me. It's still blessing me. It's still teaching me. And dad, you say, I've blown it. But I want you to know this morning that if you will, 1 John 1:9, if you will confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to wash us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you can be forgiven once again. But the last picture we see here is a fruitful father. Look at Proverbs 20, verse 7. It says, the righteous man walks in his integrity, and his children are blessed. They are happy after him. I introduced you to Nadia this morning. And about halfway through camp, Nadia is full on energy, go, go, go. And so a couple of times I saw Beth over there, their hand on her shoulder, leading and guiding, encouraging, admonishing. Time or two I looked at Nadia and I said, now Nadia? And she looks at me and she said, okay, Dad. That was endearing to me. The Bible says you have not many fathers. Faithful fathers that can be followed are becoming less and less in this world. And Nadia and Jaden and Andrew and Jacob and Ethan and Lucas and Cameron and Angel, they need to be able to see not just their own fathers, but they need to see some godly men in the house of God who are lit. Who are bussin'. Not for ourselves, but that we take this generation and we let them see us repent when we sin. But they also see that we are strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, that we have put on the whole armor of God, and by the strength and grace of God, we are standing and leading them and telling them, it's worth it. It's worth it to follow Christ. For 5 Father's Days, I have received a card from a young person who lost their father, drank himself to death,
And this year they wrote, "I did not grow up with the most God-fearing dad. When you and your family came into my life, you brought a different view, one that God knew I needed. You will forever be a father to me. You have not many fathers," Paul said. And dads, by the grace of God, I am challenging us from a broken, flawed man, but from a perfect, whole, integer word of integrity. May we be faithful fathers. May we be fathers who follow Christ in these dark days and shine the light so our children can walk beside us and walk in the light to trust and obey. One scripture, 3 John chapter 1. I guess it's only one chapter, but look at verses 3 and 4. Verse 2, he says, "Beloved," and of course the John the Revelator was just so affirming. He started out the book of John by saying, "I write to you little children." He writes as a shepherd and a father to the fatherless, to his little Christian Sunday school kids, to his ball team. He's writing and he says this, "Beloved, my kids," all throughout the book, with such affection and affirmation and adoration for these dear souls. He says, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Here it is. For I rejoiced greatly when brothers and sisters came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth." John was an old man at this point, but he said, "Look, you've been able to stick by my side, follow my example, and you're walking in the truth." And then verse 4, 3 John, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, you do faithfully." You do faithfully. We need godly, faithful fathers who will shine the light. Lindsay, you come. And will say, "Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'll go with him all the way. All the way." Dads, stay close and clean. Dads, be godly fathers. There's a whole youth group over here that need to see your example, my example, of what a godly, humble, gentle, kind, patient man of God looks like. A spirit-filled man of God. You need to be that. And Philippians 4:13, "You can do all things through Christ who gives you strength." You can do that through Christ. You say, "That's not who I am. That's not what I've been." You can come today and have a reset. You can come today and have redemption. You can come today and have a restart and say, "Lord Jesus, from this day forward, by your grace, I'm going to be a man of God and a godly father." Would you stand, please? We're going to sing a verse of invitation. I'd ask you just to bow in prayer. If you're here today and you say, "I am a father, but I'm not a godly father. And I need Christ to save me. I'm lost and I need to be found. I'm a sinner and I need to be forgiven. Because I know that my children are following me. And I got to get this dad thing right." If you're here today and you do not know Christ, I would encourage you to come forward and kneel, and I'll pray with you and say, "Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Save me. I believe that you died on the cross. I believe that you were buried and I believe that you rose again, and I believe that through the power of Christ in me, I can be a righteous father and a man of integrity from this day forward. And if you're here today, you say, I've been walking with the Lord. I know I'm saved, but I begin to stray. I begin to drift. And I need to get back close, and I need to be cleansed and walk the integrity of Christ. I would encourage you to come. Maybe bring your kids with you and say, kids, by God's grace, you're going to see a dad who's a different man through the power of Christ in me. Father, thank you for the gift of fathers. Thank you for your forgiveness. Paul said, I was the chiefest. I was the top guy for sinful men. And yet, Lord, you used him to be a spiritual father to Timothy and to Titus and to me, through the power of your word. So Lord, I pray you would encourage our fathers. Give them courage, Lord, to confess sin and allow you to forgive them and be righteous men who walk in integrity, so we can look back one day and say, my children were blessed and happy after me. May it be so, Lord. And we pray, amen. Let's sing this together. If you need to come, you come.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling.
Come on, dads.
I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and
that chorus just one more time. How about just the men? Let's sing it together, all right? Here we go, guys.
Where he leads me, I will follow.
Come on, guys.
If you're grateful for godly, blessed dads, would you give them a hand this morning? Thank you, dads. We love you. Thank you for being here today. Let's be righteous men. Walk in integrity. We love you guys. You're dismissed.